I was a sophomore in college when I was assaulted.
I was only 4.
I've attended many parole hearings for my mother's killer.
I felt helpless.
But now I have a voice.
Because I'm not alone. Because I can.
ICANN Crime Victims Assistance Network provides comprehensive victim services, including counseling and assistance at parole hearings, free of charge to victims and survivors of violence. Visit ICANN-foundation.org.
We're here to help.
This PSA was supported by funding awarded by state grant funds, UV2-104-8657 and UV2-106-8657 through the California Governor's Office of Emergency Services, Cal OES.
A bad team facing a good team is never completely out of it.
Nick Kostos, co-host of You Better You Bet, 3 to 7 p.m. Eastern on the BetQL Network.
There's 162 games in the season. The best teams are going to lose 60-plus times, and the worst teams are going to win 60-plus times. Each night is its own individual entity. That's what makes betting on the baseball regular season so much fun.
All the insight you need to bet smart is at BetQL.com and listen to You Better You Bet with Nick Kostos and Ken Barkley streaming weekdays from 3 to 7 p.m. Eastern on Odyssey.
Number three, rolling on. NHL draft coverage. Sabres on the doorstep of picking again here. Rutger McGroarty going to the from the right winger from the U.S. national team going to Winnipeg. He's going to be slated to play for Michigan University this season.
Who
University
is it?
Of Michigan. Everybody
Who isn't
is.
Going to be playing for Michigan
I
this
know.
Upcoming
Jeez.
Year?
Everybody's there.
It's that and Minnesota. Those are the two programs.
Yep.
Not Owen Power.
Becoming powerhouses.
Owen Power now on the Sabres.
Yes.
Speaking of the word power.
Yes.
Right? But Buffalo's now on deck. Vancouver on the clock. Mm-hmm. And then it's the Sabres again as we welcome you back. Our number three coverage here on WGR Sports Radio 550.
By the way, Rutger McGroarty, the second ever drafted player in NHL history to come out of Nebraska. There's your stat of the day.
Okay. Nebraska.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, not a hockey bed for sure.
Not necessarily. I mean, they have the Lincoln Omaha collegiate team, which, you know, has had its ups and downs. I think Jake Gensel came from there.
That's right.
Yeah.
Good call there. Okay. Two away. Actually, one away. Vancouver and then Buffalo. So, as you said, you did not expect McGroarty to be selected this high.
Not quite. Not quite.
So, the names that are still sitting there. Was it Joachim Kemmel?
Joachim Kemmel, yep.
Yep. Jonathan
Lekaramaki
yep. is still there.
Who I had the Sabres picking ninth overall.
These are just from multiple places where I've read, those were guys that were projected to go in the top 10 break.
Yeah, and those two guys specifically have been talked so much about having the best shot, best finish in the NHL with just their capability.
Goal scoring ability, yeah.
To find their way around the ice and become goal scoring threats. And both of those guys have miraculously fallen down the board to a spot where, you know, Vancouver's up right now. I could easily see them taking either of those guys or, I mean, they've got a lot of strong connections in Sweden. I mean, you look back to, like, mm-hmm. Elias Pettersson. But, I mean, certainly the Sabres are looking really nice and fine right now where they're at right now at number 16. They'll have a plethora of options to pick from. Could they go defense? Sure, they could. But I see them going more of the forward positions on the wing, especially.
Yeah, and you've got a handful of names still that you mentioned at pick 9, Brayton, when we had John 45 minutes ago that are still sitting there.
Yeah, it's remarkable to see how many names that are still sitting there. I mean, again, Joachim Kemmel is the highest guy that I have on my board in the mock draft at 7. Then it was Jonathan Lekaramaki to the Sabres at 9. And from there, you know, a lot of names were taken off the board. Brad Lambert's my next highest guy. Liam Ogren, who I had projected to go to the Canucks, is still available. Daniil Yurov, who could be available for the Sabres. Yurov's an interesting character just because he's another guy that a lot of people were just like, man, if the whole situation in Russia wasn't going on, he's easily a top 10 pick in this year's draft. Easily. He's got the size. He's got the skating ability. He's got the speed. And he's got the shot. But the questions pertaining to, you know, what's going on in Russia with that situation. And not only that, but when he was playing in the KHL, he got a taste of the KHL with Magnitogorsk this past year. He didn't put up much production, and a lot of people were just like, well, what's going on there? Why was that the case? He was only averaging like 3 minutes plus per game at the KHL level and didn't produce anything. No wonder why. But at the junior level in the Russia, I mean, he played really well. So there are obviously some unknowns with that situation going forward, which is probably why Yurov. I mean, I could see the Sabres taking Yurov at 16. I could see him going anywhere in this middle range of the draft. But certainly there's still some unanswered questions as to the future of everything that's going on right now, especially with the recent things with all the military stuff and players getting put in the military. Yeah.
Well, we mentioned those three, and then Brad Lampert, a player that we thought about maybe as an option at 9-2, is still there. So there's four guys, Joe, that at least three of them that were in many projections to be top 10 players that are sitting there still available, and Buffalo is going to have at least three of those four guys to pick from here as we're waiting for Vancouver's pick at number 15.
I wonder about Lambert and also their willingness to take him, given that they already had one first-round pick they've used, and they have another one coming.
Mm-hmm.
Because what was it, 4 points in Liga last year?
Yeah.
Like, it's all tools, right? You're only drafting him based on the skill set. But again, as risky as that might sound, you might be more willing to take the risk because you've got two other picks.
Well, the thing about Lambert is he put up so much big production in his junior days, and then he gets to the Finnish Liga and does relatively well. Mm. And next thing you know, he this past season, he just was underutilized at both teams that he played for. So there's a lot of questions as to how much of a drive he does have. But I really do think the talent's there. I think if he's put in the right situation, I think he can thrive.
All right, pick is in. Number 15, Vancouver. The Sabres are next. Let's see who the Canucks take.
The Vancouver Canucks are proud to select from Sweden, the SHL, Djurgården, Jonathan Lekkerbäcki.
All right. Right winger. So we get Jonathan Lekkerbäcki off the board.
Lekkerimäki
off the board, yes.
From Sweden. Patrick Alvin with a very heavy Swedish
accent there.
Yes.
I was a little late showing up the segment. We haven't heard from Matthew Savoy yet, have we?
No.
We will have his interview coming up in a moment.
I haven't heard him speak yet, but Jeremy, just, of course, got to stoke the flames right now. I'm trying to have someone reel me in on the Danny Briere comparison right now. And instead, I've got Jeremy tweeting me that he even sounds like Briere. I mean, I'm excited. I'm really excited about that pick for them.
So, by the way, just to we'll have that interview with Savoy coming up right after the Sabres make their pick here at 16. So we'll have that, and then after that Paul will go interview the player that we have here. So we'll get more reaction coming. Also, by the way, a little bit later this hour, Dan Dunleavy, Sabres play-by-play man, will be coming on to join us just to get his thoughts on the night and just the current state of the team. But the Sabres currently now on the clock. So Brayton, who's the pick here if you're Kevin Adams?
I don't know. I mean, Joachim Kemmel is interesting. Brad Lambert's interesting. Yurov is interesting. I see a lot of people on Twitter that are just like, Danila Yurov, no matter what. Yeah. I mean, sure, give me any of those three guys. I think they should go forward. I think they should go for a winger specifically. Any of those three are fine.
Is there no? I think the answer to this question is no, but I'm not sure. Is there a right shot defenseman that is in this territory?
I don't think so either.
The highest guy I see ranked is like maybe in the late 20s.
Yeah, Ryan Chesley is probably the highest ranked right shot defenseman at this point.
Then I think I would agree that just you pick the best forward that's on the board.
Yep, that's where I'm at. I mean, I'll give you a little bit about the guy that, because the way I see this draft going is obviously with the Sabres picking Savoy at number 9. I think he was BPA, best player available. I think here you're allowed to go for more of like a winger or something like that. Best player available, but that's on like the wing. Where at 28, you can go for more of like the kind of the wild card, but a reasonable wild card at best. And I think, and the guy that I picked for that in my mock draft was Maverick Lamoureux. And no, not because of Maverick and like Maverick Top Gun stuff and everything like that. I know people know that I'm a
big
Top
lie.
Gun guy. Okay, maybe there was a little. I'm kidding. No, Maverick Lamoureux, 6'7 defenseman playing in the Quebec Major Junior League with Drummondville this past year. Really good reach, really long reach. A guy that big, though, a lot of people think like, he's probably got to skate really awkwardly. He's actually a very smooth skating defenseman. He can provide a nice little bit of offense when needed, but he's really good. He's already built into his size quite well, so he's not afraid to step up on the blue line and lay a check on a guy or play physical. So it's just the thing that I've read a lot about with Lamoureux is he's a long-term project. He's more of a guy that you give him the rest of his 2 years of eligibility in the queue, and then he comes to the AHL, and then you give him another year there, maybe another 2 years in the AHL, and then he gets to the NHL and is ready to go and ready to thrive as well. So certainly in that 28 range or wherever the Sabres end up picking later on in the first round, that's probably where you might start to see a guy where the Sabres maybe reach a little bit, but it's not like far-reaching for a guy.
Just a reminder, by the way, this the Sabres being on the clock here, if you haven't been like all in on the draft talk, this is the pick they obtained from Vegas in the Jack Eichel deal.
And I was just about to ask you guys, do you feel like, and this probably just depended on your opinion of how good Peyton Krebs can become, do the Sabres need to nail this pick to outright win the Eichel trade?
I mean, you don't want to grab a guy that you're projecting to go in like 25.
But like, if this guy becomes, you know, a third, fourth, like a bottom six role player, is it still a win? Because if they nail the pick, everyone, not just in Buffalo, but around hockey, is going to give them a lot of credit for the return.
Here's the next question, Joe. Would he be a third liner on like a team a few years ago where the third liner's kind of like, not great? Or is it a third liner where it's just like, oh, he could flip up the lineup easily?
Yeah, no, I'm almost like a little more like disappointing. Like if they got a Mittelstadt level player.
I knew you were going there. Yeah, for sure.
I think this is how we'll look back on the trade for sure. I mean, this is the biggest trade for the Sabres since when? I mean,
LaFontaine Turgeon?
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, we're talking at least 30 years.
You're trading a superstar, all-star level player, possible future Hall of Fame level player.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That I think you've got to go back to Turgeon LaFontaine for that much firepower in a deal. And so far, the rave reviews are in on Alex Tuch. So far, Peyton Krebs' potential seems to be super exciting and intriguing. But a big piece of this trade was the first pick, which, by the way, at the time of the trade versus what it is now, looks even a little better in terms of the positioning. I did not expect it to be pick 16. I was thinking it would be somewhere in the 20s.
Right.
So
16 was like the best possible
result. You actually got a little thing that was out of your control to go in your favor, which was Vegas kind of really being bad down the stretch of the season here, to put you in a spot now where some of these guys that have fallen that were top 10 projected players to now be sitting here on the board. But now we're going to get a chance to hear what Kevin Adams has to say.
Real quick, there's no doubt the Pegulas, Kevin Adams, the whole organization, they're going to want to nail this pick. They don't even want to just win the pick.
Yeah.
Or win the trade. They want to run away with it. For how much flack they got for the O'Reilly trade, they're going to want to crush it here.
Yeah. All right, Sabres ready to make their second pick of the night at 16th overall, the pick obtained in the Jack Eichel trade. Let's go to Montreal and pick up the feed.
With the 16th pick, the Buffalo Sabres are proud to select from your garden in the Swedish Hockey League, Noah Oslund,
okay. The selection by the Sabres there. Center from the Swedish Hockey
League. Another center.
Another Swedish center in the middle of the first round. Although it was Rosin wasn't a center. A winger, maybe last year when they picked him?
He's technically a winger, but like they were talking like, oh, we could see him playing center. It's just like, okay.
Noah Oslund.
Another center.
Not Danila Yurov, like everybody was. Were they even like campaigning for it or just saying they thought it was going to happen because of the VP from Metallurg?
Yeah, I don't know.
Not even sure.
But all right, so this obviously a name maybe, Brayton, we didn't think about at this spot with, you know, I guess because of the thought of look at who's still available. I guess maybe that's more so it. So
right.
What can you tell us and what do you know about this guy here so far, Noah Oslund?
Well, Noah Oslund obviously is a really good centerman that was playing in Sweden last year. And as I mentioned earlier in the show, he was a guy that was playing on a line with Liam Ogren and Jonathan Lekkerimäki. So a couple of Djurgården players going 15 and 16 in this draft. But Noah Oslund last year in Sweden with Djurgårdens in the junior level, he put up 9 goals and 33 assists for 42 points. In the Swedish Hockey League at the professional level, he didn't put up anything in 11 games. He's obviously going to move up to the professional level with the top team next year, playing in Hockey Allsvenskan, which is the second tier league. But you know, certainly a guy that sees the ice really well down the middle, a good playmaker. Here's what Cam Robinson wrote at eliteprospects.com. At his best, Oslund is a dynamic, shifty playmaker who takes full advantage of the width of the ice to build passing sequences, a dexterous distributor, I love that, with the full array of reach, adjusted passes, and the keen eye to find options throughout traffic. He was the most prolific setup man in the entire Swedish junior circuit this past year.
Okay, playmaker is what.
Yes,
I'll summarize.
Playmaker,
all that
distributor,
into one word. Yeah.
And here's another thing too that I've been thinking about a lot over the past week or so with these picks. The Sabres obviously have 11 picks in this year's draft, 3 in the first round. They're set up not only to build up their prospect system and to actually be really good down the line eventually. They're setting themselves up for a good chance where, if they're in a spot where come trade deadline or even during the offseason at some point, whether it's this offseason, next offseason, they get in an interesting situation where a player all of a sudden becomes available, they have assets, they have weapons to be able to go out and get a player or get an asset that they really, really want to add to the core and add to the group to make themselves that much better a little bit quicker. And maybe that's something that I think Tim Murray wanted to do right off the bat when he was the general manager of the Buffalo Sabres and just failed to do so. Now, Kevin Adams, obviously, I think we've seen he's been a little more methodical, which is with his approach to try and play this out in the right way and play the right cards at the right time. Whereas Murray was just like, you know, we're just going to trade these pieces and we're going to get the assets. And no matter how their chemistry is or whatever, they were going to fit in. They're talented. They'll gel eventually and they'll play well.
Yeah.
Didn't necessarily end up that way. This could be a situation where things could work out really well for the Buffalo Sabres in that way, where if they get the right player, the right asset to come on the trade market or to become available, and they have to trade any of their assets, whether it's this year's picks or future, you know, picks from last year or 2 years ago, why not, right?
Loading up in terms of the center position too, Joe. We just had this discussion before this selection was even made.
Yeah.
Now you're adding another one here to the file.
Another shorter one, by the way. 5'10".
Yeah.
I wonder what Paul thinks. Paul was asking Kevin Adams about the size going into this draft. And I'm not against getting faster. And if that has to come at, you know, in return, you're going to have to be getting smaller as a lineup, then I'm good with it. Although Oslund doesn't read like he's this elite speed guy. Like he's a good skater, but Savoy is more like he's going to fly up and down the ice.
Yeah.
Oslund is getting more credit for hockey IQ, being deceptive.
Yes, he's got the vision. He's really got the keen sense of where everything is and developing on the ice. And I think that's what made him so intriguing. Here's some of the prospect rankings that Oslund was ranked at, and this is all listed at eliteprospects.com as well. He was 27th by eliteprospects.com, 24th by SC Hockey. Bob McKenzie had him 22nd, 22nd by McKean's Hockey, 30th by Craig Button with TSN, and 18th by NHL Central Scouting for European skaters. So certainly in the mid to late teens and into the 20s more so. So maybe this is one of those, like, you're more reaching for this guy at this point, but I'm not going to complain.
So it also could be a player that they really valued and they wanted, and they realized, look, when we pick at 28, we don't want to risk him not being there, which, you know, based upon those projections you just gave us, it would be a risk for the Sabres to hope that he falls to 28. So if this is a guy that they really wanted, then, you know, why not take him now? This is the spot to do it.
The other interesting thing is he was between Bob McKenzie, and this is only Bob McKenzie's list, but of Bob McKenzie's rankings from mid-season to final, from his mid-season rankings to his final rankings, Noah Oslund was the highest riser. He went from 59th at his mid-season rankings to 22nd.
Yeah.
So nobody had a bigger jump.
Yeah, that's
so this
impressive.
Was a guy that rose higher and higher as this past season went on.
And just remember, Bob McKenzie's rankings for scouting and everything like that, he's channeling in other scouts and other NHL personnel's thoughts on players and putting it all together in whatever algorithm he has. Then he puts his rankings together. So this is from other NHL personnel that Bob McKenzie's getting these thoughts from, and then he's putting this list together and ranking them and then saying, hey, here's what this scout or these scouts really like about this player.
And maybe the rise, as you said, in the rankings, whether you want to define him as a late bloomer, someone with still maybe, you know, is in the heat of growing right now. I mean, that's something that obviously was attractive to the Sabres. Okay, so right now they actually are kind of putting a pause as we hit the halfway point of the draft. Joe Sakic being honored by the league right now for the Jim Gregory General Manager of the Year Award. Gary Bettman just presented it to him. Obviously, the Avalanche winning the Cup this year, I'm sure, had a big piece in that.
I was going to say, really going out on a limb there, giving GM of the Year to the guy that won the Cup.
I know. Anyway, okay, so Noah Oslin is the pick for the Sabres here. Again, they'll pick again at 28th. So a little time right now before the Sabres pick again. So while this is happening, we're going to hear from Matthew Savoy in just one moment. Paul Hamilton also is going to speak with Noah Oslin, so we'll have that interview. Also coming up later this hour, Dan Dunleavy, Sabres play-by-play man. So we got a lot to get to here as we react. Brayton, thank you for your work here. I know we may check in with you one more time throughout the night, but thank you for your work here so far.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, let's go to Montreal. Let's hear from the newest Sabre, Matthew Savoy, here with Paul Hamilton.
Thank you.
So what was it like for you watching that chaos unfold and wait to hear your name called?
Yeah, it was definitely a bit of a hectic situation. You know, never been through an experience like that before, but you know, now to see it finally come full circle, it's truly a blessing. I'm super excited to be a part of the Sabre organization, and you know, can't wait to get to work down there.
What do you feel like right now? Just what are the emotions?
Just excitement for me. You know, I was a bit nervous coming into the day. You know, be a lot of pressure at some times, but you know, now that you get finally picked and you have a destination, I think you can really set your eyes on a goal and really start to get to work.
Ben, I know you had a lot of talk with them during the year, during the combine. Just what are your impressions of this organization, what they're trying to build with so much young talent?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's definitely a first-class organization. They have a ton of good young players, good prospects, and as well good leadership, good veteran guys. I think they're definitely moving in the right direction, and I'm really happy to be joining it.
From your meetings, did you get a sense that maybe it could be the Sabres?
Yeah, I think you know, the meetings can be a bit tricky at times. They try not to give away too much, but you can definitely sense out when a team likes you a little bit more than others. So I think my meetings with Buffalo went really well, and you know, to be here today, drafted by them, is really exciting.
Matt, congratulations. The question I wanted to ask you was, you know, what was the impact that the Winnipeg Ice organization had on your development and, you know, getting to this point?
Yeah, the Winnipeg Ice had a huge impact. You know, going there at such a young age, getting to practice with 19 or 20 year old guys, being a 15 year old was so critical for my development. You know, continuing to push myself, play against the best competition possible, I think is really what shaped the player I am today.
How excited are you to be in the same organization as Dave Kraft? Have the spot of at some point, you know, being able to play the same team?
Yeah, I got a few games in with Krebsy when I was 15, roomed on the road together with him a couple times, so pretty familiar with him, and really ecstatic to you know, reconnect with him and you know, go down there and see him for sure.
What kind of lessons did you take playing for him?
He's a true pro. He always wants the best from his players. The mentality he brings to the rink every day, he's so dialed in, focused. I think it just wears off on guys to be the best possible version of themselves and really focus on their goals.
During the pandemic, going to the USHL, you know, when you get back to Winnipeg, I mean, what was it like just comparing where your game was at when you were first with Winnipeg and then where you were at this season?
Yeah, I think from a confidence standpoint, it just went skyrocketed. You know, I felt more comfortable with the puck on my stick, felt more comfortable taking checks, you know, reading plays. So I think just growing as a player and getting older as a player was huge for me, and I think that's what allowed me to have some success this year.
Did you not, I mean, maybe not surprise yourself, but when you look back at the season and the jump you made,
yeah, you know, growing up, I was always a really offensive-based player. Obviously, that first year in Winnipeg was a bit tough with the scheduling and everything, and only getting 22 games in. But you know, I just took it as another way to keep improving. Really put my head down and work, and I think I did a good job of that in the USHL. I thought that was a really good development year for me, and coming back to Winnipeg really had my eyes set on having a strong, you know, draft season, and I think I did that.
Where do we stand right now with the shoulder?
The recovery's fully done. Medically, it's completely healed. Now it's just getting strength back in it. You know, continuing to manage my workouts and making sure you know, I'm not pushing it too hard too soon. And but from a medical standpoint, it's all good. Yeah, when I was ordering my suit, they asked what I wanted in the inside. They gave me, you know, a couple options, and I just thought I wanted to pick one of the coolest looking ones. So went with the tiger one, and decided to stick with it.
Have you been back on the ice yet?
Just briefly, one or two times, just, you know, to get the legs back into it before camp here, but. Looking forward to really getting back into the bulk of skating in July here.
Do you think you could participate in camp next week?
I think that's a conversation that'll be had with the management, but you know, I'm looking forward to getting down to Buffalo for sure.
Have you visited Buffalo yet or spent any time there?
I was there for the combine in early June, but other than that, never really been to Buffalo or around the city, so excited to, you know, go explore and go check it out and see what it's like.
Do you view yourself as a center or a wing? I mean, which one are you more comfortable just through the time and through your development so far?
I think, you know, I leave that up to my coaches. I'm really comfortable playing both positions. The last four or five seasons, I've flip-flopped consistently back and forth, so I think, you know, versatility in that sense is one of my strengths.
Did you play mostly center last year, though?
Yeah, I played center for probably the first half of the season, and then for the second half of the season was rotating back and forth between center and wing.
Thanks,
guys.
Okay, Matthew Savoy there, Sabres' first of two picks. Noah Ostlund, the other selection as well. Sabres will pick again at pick 28. Okay, Joe, we have another player that can play center or wing.
He can.
He said he's comfortable playing both. He's played both quite a bit, and he even said last year... Flip-flop back and forth, started center, then rotated to wing. So maybe the versatility is also something that was attractive to Kevin Adams.
Yeah. You know, Don Granato's one to experiment with things and, you know, get a little creative. If they have five
Tage Thompson. Yeah.
Tage Thompson, right.
Yeah.
If they have... I've been throwing out this dream scenario where everybody develops perfectly, which is not real life, but let's just say it happens. You've got Thompson, you've got Cousins, you've got Krebs, Mittelstadt, and now you've got Savoy, and you have Ostlund. That's six. If they all turn into pretty good players, and you all feel comfortable with all of them playing center, Don Granato might be the guy that goes, all right, I'm going to use them in different spots every time. So, like, yeah. This game, because of this matchup, you know, maybe I like Ostlund better at center than I like Thompson. Or this game, I kind of want Krebs on the wing. I want because of this matchup. Or, you know what, this guy's having a bad game, so let me flip-flop him in the second line. It's a good problem to have because you can either move guys around the lineup. It's easier to go from center to wing than the other way around. So you can move guys around the lineup to make it work, get the most talent possible on the ice. Or we could go with your idea, which is you got six great centermen, and oh, suddenly I'm kind of short on right-shot defensemen. Let me flip one for a really good right-shot defenseman.
Yeah. The options are there, clearly, for sure. And this is what happens when you have the bulk of picks. Now, the patience meter is going to have to be... If you want to ask Sabre fans to have more patience than they already have, you know, after missing the playoffs 11 seasons in a row, now the excitement of tonight... That's the only thing that always bums me out about NHL draft night is that, unlike the NFL draft, where you're like, oh, where can we plug them in?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, unless you're getting a guy in the top 3 to 5 most years, you got to wait, which unfortunately is less fun.
And sometimes you got to wait several years.
Yeah.
You know, like Isaac Rosén, who they picked 14th last year, he doesn't seem like he's ready for that jump. I mean, that's been 1 year of development in Sweden. That's almost certainly, I think, going to be another year of development, and then maybe the year after. So maybe because of where they're picked, Savoy is more likely to be a guy that plays in the NHL next year. But maybe Ostlund's an extra year after that. So you're right. Like, that's the downside of it. It is good on the Sabres to get development camp right out in front of people next week, the 13th. And Kevin Adams said that his plan last week was that a lot of the guys they draft will be there. So we'll see. That hasn't been determined yet. But the good news is, if you want to see these guys on the ice really quickly, you'll have an opportunity next week down at Harbor Center.
Yeah, that'll happen on Wednesday, the 13th.
13th through the 16th is what I got here.
Yeah, they've got the French Connection scrimmages that'll happen there along the way. But an opportunity to maybe see some of these development camp, these players at development camp is coming up here. If you want to go and make plans, all the sessions will be at Harbor Center. They're free and open to the public. It's first come, first serve basis. I would bet maybe the practices, at the very least, aren't going to sell out. The French Connection Tournament, the three-on-three thing, maybe could. That's on Saturday at 9:15. But if you are wanting to go, the first sessions will be next Wednesday afternoon. They have two sessions. Session one is from 2:30 to 3:30, and then session two is from 4 to 5. So if you want to see some of these players that they're going to be drafting here today and tomorrow, you can see them next Wednesday, 2:30. Down at Harbor Center. Okay, timeout. We still got Dan Dunleavy going to be joining us shortly. We'll go back to Montreal with Paul. Also, Noah Östlund, the draft pick just a few picks ago from the Sabres. Paul will have that interview coming up too as we roll on. And the Sabres still to pick at pick 28. We're at 18 right now with Dallas on the clock. As we continue on, our coverage of the NHL draft on WGR brought to you by Fiegel Carr and Joyce. Your border attorneys by Bath Fitter. Improve your bath with in one day with Bath Fitter. It just fits. By Outlet Liquor. When you need to stock up, it's the place to buy a case. What's your outlet? And by M&M, you pull it. Western New York's premier destination for used car and truck parts. Brayton Wilson, TJ Luckman, Joe DiBiase, Paul Hamilton. I'm Brian Colziel. Dan Dunleavy to come here shortly as well as we roll on our continuing coverage of the NHL draft on WGR. Welcome back. Brian Colziel, Joe DiBiase, Brayton Wilson, Paul Hamilton in Montreal, TJ Luckman producing. Appreciate you being with us. I'm going to talk to Sabres play-by-play man Dan Dunleavy shortly here as we get rolling on toward the Sabres' third and final pick of the night at pick 28. If you're just joining us, Buffalo selecting twice already. We just heard from Matthew Savoy from Winnipeg of the Western Hockey League. Noah Östlund is the second pick, another center, who says he can also play wing. He's flip-flop back and forth. Paul Hamilton in Montreal interviewing him right now. We'll have that interview coming up here shortly.
We only have one Russian player drafted through 18 picks. Just want to point that out.
Yeah, I think people are just nervous about it.
They're nervous. They're scared off of it a little bit. I mean, I've wondered. I don't think we've had much detail on it because probably they don't even know. But the four prospects the Sabres signed or drafted last year, we know one of them's here. Kisikov, their second-round pick. He's actually in Montreal because Sabres tweeted out a picture of him. He signed his entry-level deal, so it sounds like he's here. The one guy I wonder about the most for the future of, and when he might be ready to come over and when he could come over and how dangerous that might be, is Prokhor Poltepov, who was the Sabres' first second-round pick last year. He plays for CSKA Moscow, which is that club in the KHL with a military affiliation that caused the Flyers goalie prospect to sign with the Flyers and then get arrested for basically trying to dodge the military. So that's such a complicating factor right now and a worry for these guys with the war in Ukraine that wasn't present the last time these GMs were drafting a year ago.
Yeah. By the way, you know, we kind of poked fun at Joe Sakic winning the GM of the Year award. Like, way to go out on a limb, NHL, right? By giving it to the guy that won the Stanley Cup. Kevin Adams received a third-place vote.
Okay.
He finished 11th in the voting with a point.
With one single point? It's deserved, right? It's been a pretty good first year.
Who votes on that?
Let's see here.
Is it other GMs, maybe? Or is it media?
I don't have. I just have the first, second-place breakdown. I don't know
who
did it. But Minnesota has just made their pick at 19, and Liam Ogren, left winger from Sweden. So that player, Liam Ogren, now off the board. Washington at pick 20 is now there. But yes, Joe Sakic, finishing first in the GM of the Year award. Julien Brisebois from Tampa, second,
yep.
87.
I've and got
Chris Drury, third, 53 votes, 53 points. Kevin Adams, though, did get one third-place vote.
Yeah, I'm wondering who gave him that vote, because here it says that voting is conducted among the 31 team general managers and a panel of five executives and five media members at the conclusion of the regular season. Hmm. So playoffs don't even count in this arrangement here.
Does he strike you as someone that would vote for himself?
I was wondering the same thing.
I feel like he's not.
No.
I'd be surprised.
Not yet.
Me too.
He's too young in the process.
Which Sabre GMs would have voted for themselves?
Tim Murray.
Oh, yeah, that's an easy one. I mean, why do I even need to ask that?
You
were
such done
a layup.
Asking the question.
It is a layup. Tim Murray would have voted for himself.
He would have given himself a first place vote.
Oh, for sure.
Every time.
Yeah.
we could probably check that.
Is it fair to say you have confidence in Sabre's management? Is that too strong?
Right now?
Do you have confidence right now in Sabre's management? It's trending that way, at least. What would their approval rating be among fans?
They've made good hires over the year that I've liked, especially in their analytics department with Sam Ventura.
They have, like, there's that chart.
Am I counting the coach in this answer?
Yes.
Or am I separating?
Sure. Yes. I think you're counting the coach.
Because with Granato, I have a if you're packaging coach and GM and scouting staff,
all of it, yep.
With Granato in that mix, it's a higher grade for me for sure. I think he's leading the charge of my confidence level. I would say Adams is trending on the good side, but Granato, I'm like, you know, if you said, hey, do the Sabres have the right coach, I'm like 90% on yes.
I think I am too. I mean, the jury is still out, and the next step, all right, what have you proven so far? One, you could tear it down. That's already a step further than Jason Botterill. Jason Botterill showed up and just watched Murray's team, right, for 2 years. Like, he tinkered with it, and he made the O'Reilly trade. But for the most part, there was no teardown that ever happened with Botterill. Adams proved he could do that.
Yep.
And he got a great package for Ristolainen. So far, so good on the Eichel package, and we'll see on the Reinhardt package. But so far, he showed he could tear it down and get a lot of pieces. He showed so far that, all right, the drafting seems to be pretty good. It's way too early to tell how good he is at drafting, because we really only have, we have 8 games of power, and we have 4 games between Paterka and Quinn. But that's going well. Paterka and Quinn, the development's going well. So the next step in whether or not he's the right GM is, we've seen you tear it down, we've seen you replenish the prospect pool. The next step is, can you make the moves that take you from up-and-coming team to, okay, I'm actually contending for the playoffs?
Was there a point where we were having this discussion about McDermott and Bean, where you said, okay, I'm trusting the coach, mm-hmm. I'm trusting the GM, it's heading in the right direction? Now, obviously, we know the Bills have gotten it to where Brandon Bean is now getting the talk of being the best GM in football, assembling the most talented team in the NFL. Like, I'm trying to see if I can picture back, like, okay, were we
Where were we? Where were we? At this point, we're right with the Sabres. When was that for the Bills? Is that, like, the beginning of the 2019 season?
Yeah. I would say that's right. TJ, turn
Your mic's on.
My bad, guys.
The 2017 season was almost by accident, like making the playoffs.
You're right.
Like, that was their teardown season. Even though they made the playoffs, it was their teardown season.
Maybe that's the moment that proved us right.
Even
when not going all in, they still figured out a way to have success.
Well, because 2018 wasn't going well, but they had broken the drought, and they were building things back up. Like, we knew they were just starting to put their core group of pieces together. 2019, it was like, all right, let's sign John Brown, let's sign Cole Beasley, and it's go time.
Yeah.
Diggs, the next year, is like all in. So, like, we knew you had the right group. You knew everything was right.
So the DeBrincat thing that you said today about it being too early, would that be like the Bills signing Diggs in the 2017 offseason?
I think so.
Just, like, not ready yet for it?
You needed proof of concept. You needed to know this group is worth that all-in move. And I think we're all hopeful that this Sabres group will be worth an all-in move like that down the road. But I think you're jumping a little bit too far if you say you know that this group is it for the Sabres. You think it's trending that way, and we're optimistic and hopeful, but it's not solidified in my mind yet.
And maybe the star power has shifted with the Sabres, where we know the Bills, okay, you have Josh Allen. You've got the most important position covered.
Yes.
The Sabres right now, with Eichel being out, you're saying, do you have your star center, number one center? Well, I don't know if that answer is yes quite yet, but I do know that maybe defensively, I could have the
right
an amazing 1-2 punch with Dahlin Power leading the way. Now, yep. I still need a goalie, and maybe, hopefully, Tage Thompson can turn into... Maybe he'll never be as good as Jack Eichel, but maybe he'll put up the same numbers that Jack Eichel does. Look at last year, he had more goals than Jack Eichel did. Career-wise, yeah.
The two hardest things to find are a franchise centerman and a franchise defenseman. And it feels like they have the franchise defenseman. They might even have two.
They might have two.
And the center, I wouldn't say they have it, but it's different from football in that like you can't fix quarterback by doing it in volume. Because of the nature of the sport.
Right.
Hockey, like the Sabres could get away with not having a franchise centerman if they've got three really good ones. Or and, maybe, you know, I am open to at least Savoy because of how dynamic he is offensively. I'm open to him becoming that guy.
But the league has shown that there's different ways to
get
it done.
Right.
Where the NFL...
There's one way.
We know if you don't have a dynamic quarterback, you're not going to win unless...
Wasting time.
I shouldn't even say that unless the rest of your team's perfect. I even think that era's over. The Baltimore Ravens with Trent Dilfer at quarterback or, you know, even some of these other teams that have maybe gotten in. The Buccaneers with Brad Johnson goes back a little farther. Yeah. Like, just... I just think in the NFL, you just have to have the quarterback. Okay, the Bills have that. So, but you're right. In the NHL, as we saw with Montreal even, now maybe it was fluky, but they had the superstar goalie and they ended up in the Stanley Cup final.
Right.
So maybe the Sabres will have two all-star level Hall of Fame potential defensemen with Dahlin and with Power together. And that is maybe the backbone of your team. And now, you know, as you said, the collection of centermen being great. Okay, we're going to shift gears. Go live to Montreal. Paul Hamilton standing by with the Sabres' second pick tonight. Here's Noah Ostlund with Paul Hamilton. Go ahead, Paul.
Thank you, Brian. Noah, congratulations. How did you feel when you heard your name?
Yeah, I got super excited and very happy. I feel very pumped up to get to the Buffalo organization.
Did you have an idea that it might be Buffalo that would take you?
Yeah, I've had a couple of great meetings with them, and I feel like the staff really believes in me, and I think it would be a great fit for me.
What made you think that you did have a good meeting with them? What did you think went well with them?
Yeah, I know. I felt safe when I was in there, didn't get so stressed, and it felt like they really liked me as a person, so that may be it.
Do you like the fact that there are a couple of guys from Sweden? We're talking about Rasmus Dahlin, Rasmus Asplund. Guys that maybe you don't know, but at least some guys from your country that maybe can help show you the way.
Yeah, it mean a lot. Maybe get to know them a little bit, and they would take care of me very good, I think. So get an easier ride into the organization, that would be very good for me.
Tell me a little bit about yourself. I know you're a centerman. Have you played any wing before, or are you just mostly a centerman?
Yeah, I played wing until I was 16 years old, so I played two-year center, but next year I will start playing wing again, and then we'll see throughout the season how it goes.
Is there one position you think you're better at or one position that you like better?
Yeah, I would say center. I think I get more involved in the game, and both defensively and offensively, so I would say center.
Now, the Sabres have a development camp. I know you just got taken by them, but probably a pretty good chance we will see you next week at development camp?
Yeah, it would be good. I have my equipment with me, so it would be a good experience.
How far away do you think you are? You know, as an 18-year-old, there's development that has to happen. What are your plans for next year as far as playing, and how far away do you think you are?
Yeah, I think maybe two more years in Sweden. Then I think I will be ready to play 82 games and playoffs in the NHL.
Thanks so much for stopping by, and congratulations again.
Thank you.
Brian, that's the second number one pick, Noah Ostlund, which they took 16th overall. We're at 21 overall now, so without any trades, Buffalo is up in seven picks. Back to you.
All right, Paul, thank you very much. Great job there. Joe, he sounds pretty pumped.
I agree. Did you hear his exact phrasing? He said, probably two more years in Sweden, then I'll be ready for 82 games and playoffs.
Love it.
And playoffs.
And playoffs.
Love it.
He's ready to go. All right, Noah Ostlund there. And as Paul said, Pittsburgh's on the clock right now, 21st, and Buffalo picking at 28, so still another pick to go. Okay, timeout. More draft coverage coming up. We'll take a timeout here on WGR.
I was a sophomore in college when I was assaulted.
I was only 4.
I've attended many parole hearings for my mother's killer.
I felt helpless.
But now I have a voice.
Because I'm not alone. Because I can.
ICANN Crime Victims Assistance Network provides comprehensive victim services, including counseling and assistance at parole hearings free of charge to victims and survivors of violence. Visit ICANN-foundation.org.
We're here to help.
This PSA was supported by funding awarded by state grant funds, UV2-104-8657 and UV2-106-8657 through the California Governor's Office of Emergency Services, Cal OES.
Did you have a dream last night? If not, are you sure?
Everyone dreams for about 2 hours per night.
We just don't have the tape recorder running.
Do pilots get jet lag? Are we ever going to get a hangover cure? Did the dinosaurs have feathers?
They had feathers.
Figured I'd give you that one. My name is Mike Simpson. This is what we do on my podcast. It's called I've Got Questions. Chameleons are not what you think. Beer used to be a drink at breakfast. Let's learn some stuff. New episodes Thursdays. I've Got Questions on Odyssey or wherever you get your podcasts.
I'm Matt Spiegel, and I'm the host of the brand new podcast, Beat the Streak Daily. Every weekday this major league season, I will update the state of Beat the Streak. The rules are simple. Each day, pick one or two players you think will get a hit. And if they do, your streak continues. Sounds doable, right? But so far, it's been impossible to win. And with millions of dollars on the line, no one has ever gotten to 56. Subscribe now to Beat the Streak Daily, wherever you get your podcasts, and play Beat the Streak for your chance to win $5.6 million.
How's your mental health? I'm listening with Michael Phelps.
You know, I think for me in 2014, when I found myself in that dark, dark place where I didn't want to be alive in those 4 days when I was in my room by myself, after sitting there and thinking about everything, I wanted to find a different way. I wanted to find a different answer. I was sick and tired of feeling how I felt, and that's why I started to seek help. And that's when I checked myself into a treatment center.
More at imlistening.org. Talk saves lives.
Welcome to History Is Us. I'm Dr. Eddie Esclaw Jr. Join me as we journey through history to face the ugly truths at the heart of the American story. Throughout this series, we explore who we are as a nation. Listen to History Is Us, a creation and presentation of Shining City Audio, a C13 Originals, and John Meacham Studio. Available now on the Odyssey app or wherever you listen to your podcasts.